This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Israeli-Palestinian conflict, Hebrew, Hayiksuk Hayisraeli-Falastini, Arabic, Al-Nizaa Al-Filastini Al-Israeli, is the ongoing struggle between Israelis and Palestinians that began in the mid-20th century. The conflict is wide-ranging, and the term is sometimes also used in reference to the earlier sectarian conflict in Mandatory Palestine, between the Jewish Yishuv and the Arab population under British rule. It has been referred to as the world's most intractable conflict, with the ongoing Israeli occupation of the West Bank and the Gaza Strip reaching 49 years despite a long-term peace process and the general reconciliation of Israel with Egypt and Jordan. Israelis and Palestinians have failed to reach a final peace agreement. The key issues are mutual recognition, borders, security, water rights, control of Jerusalem, Israeli settlements, Palestinian freedom of movement, and Palestinian right of return. The violence of the conflict, in a region rich in sites of historic, cultural, and religious interest worldwide, has been the object of numerous international conferences dealing with historic rights, security issues and human rights, and has been a factor hampering tourism in and general access to areas that are hotly contested. Many attempts have been made to broker a two-state solution, involving the creation of an independent Palestinian state alongside the State of Israel after Israel's establishment in 1948. In 2007, the majority of both Israelis and Palestinians, according to a number of polls, preferred the two-state solution over any other solution as a means of resolving the conflict. Moreover, a majority of Jews see the Palestinians' demand for an independent state as just, and thinks Israel can agree to the establishment of such a state. The majority of Palestinians and Israelis in the West Bank and Gaza Strip have expressed a preference for a two-state solution. Mutual distrust and significant disagreements are deep over basic issues, as is the reciprocal skepticism about the other side's commitment to upholding obligations in an eventual agreement within Israeli and Palestinian society. The conflict generates a wide variety of views and opinions. This highlights the deep divisions which exist not only between Israelis and Palestinians, but also within each society. A hallmark of the conflict has been the level of violence witnessed for virtually its entire duration. Fighting has been conducted by regular armies, paramilitary groups, terror cells, and individuals. Casualties have not been restricted to the military, with a large number of fatalities in civilian population on both sides. There are prominent international actors involved in the conflict. The two parties engaged in direct negotiation are the Israeli government, currently led by Benjamin Netanyahu, and the Palestine Liberation Organization PLO, currently headed by Mahmoud Abbas. The official negotiations are mediated by an international contingent known as the Quartet on the Middle East. The quartet, represented by a special envoy, that consists of the United States, Russia, the European Union, and the United Nations. The Arab League is another important actor, which has proposed an alternative peace plan. Egypt, a founding member of the Arab League, has historically been a key participant since 2006. The Palestinian side has been fractured by conflict between the two major factions, Fatah, the traditionally dominant party, and its later electoral challenger, Hamas. After Hamas's electoral victory in 2006, the quartet conditioned future foreign assistance to the Palestinian National Authority PA on the future government's commitment to non-violence, recognition of the State of Israel, and acceptance of previous agreements. Hamas rejected these demands, which resulted in the quartet's suspension of its foreign assistance program, and the imposition of economic sanctions by the Israelis a year later. Following Hamas's seizure of power in the Gaza Strip in June 2007, the territory officially recognized as the PA was split between Fatah in the West Bank, and Hamas in the Gaza Strip. The division of governance between the parties had effectively resulted in the collapse of bipartisan governance of the PA. However, in 2014, a Palestinian unity government, composed of both Fatah and Hamas, was formed. The latest round of peace negotiations began in July 2013 and was suspended in 2014. Contents. 1. Background. 2. History. 3. Peace process. 31. Oslo Accords 1993. 32. Camp David Summit 2033. Developments following Camp David. 34. Taba Summit 2001. 35. Roadmap for Peace. 36. Arab Peace Initiative. 37. Present status. 371. Israel's settlement policy. 372. Israeli military police. 373. Incitement. 374. UN and the Palestinian state. 375. Public support. 4 current issues in dispute. 41. Jerusalem. 42. Holy sites. 43 Palestinian refugees, 44 Israeli security concerns, 45 Palestinian violence outside of Israel, 46 Israeli violence outside of Palestine, 47 Palestinian violence against other Palestinians, 48 international status, 49 water resources, 491 future and financing, 410 Israeli military occupation of the West Bank, 411 Israeli settlements in the West Bank, 412 Gaza blockade, 413 agriculture, 4,131 The West Bank barrier, 4,132 boycotts, 5 actions towards stabilizing the conflict, 51 mutual recognition, 52 government, 53 societal attitudes. 54 Palestinian Army, 6 fatalities, 1948-2011-61 Criticism of casualty statistics, 62 land mine and explosive remnants of war casualties, 7 See also 8 Notes 9 References 10 External links Background Main article, Sectarian conflict in Mandatory Palestine. The Israeli-Palestinian conflict has its roots in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, with the birth of major nationalist movements among the Jews and among the Arabs, both geared towards attaining sovereignty for their people in the Middle East. The collision between those two forces in southern Levant and the emergence of Palestinian nationalism in the 1920s eventually escalated into the Israeli-Palestinian conflict in 1947, and expanded into the wider Arab-Israeli conflict later on with the outcome of the First World War. The relations between Zionism and the Arab national movement seemed to be potentially friendly, and the Faisal-Weizmann agreement created a framework for both aspirations to coexist on the former Ottoman Empire's territories. However, with the defeat and dissolution of the Arab Kingdom of Syria in July 1920 following the Franco-Syrian War, a crisis fell upon the Damascus-based Arab National Movement. The return of several hard-line Palestinian Arab nationalists, under the emerging leadership of Haj Amin al-Husseini, from Damascus to Mandatory Palestine marked the beginning of Palestinian Arab nationalist struggle towards establishment of a national home for Arabs of Palestine. Amin al-Husseini, the architect of the Palestinian Arab National Movement, immediately marked Jewish national movement and Jewish immigration to Palestine as the sole enemy to his cause, initiating large-scale riots against the Jews as early as 1920 in Jerusalem and in 1921 in Jaffa. Among the results of the violence was the establishment of the Jewish paramilitary force Haganah in 1929. A series of violent anti-Jewish riots was initiated by the Arab leadership. The riots resulted in massive Jewish casualties in Hebron and Safed, and the evacuation of Jews from Hebron and Gaza. The Arab Revolt of 1936-39 in Palestine, motivated by opposition to mass Jewish immigration in the early 1930s, the Arab national struggle in Palestine had drawn many Arab nationalist militants from across the Middle East, most notably Sheikh Izzaddin al-Qassam from Syria, who established the Black Hand militant group and had prepared the grounds for the 1936 Arab Revolt following the death of al-Qassam at the hands of the British in late 1935, the tensions erupted. In 1936 into the Arab general strike and general boycott. The strike soon deteriorated into violence and the bloodily repressed 1936-1939 Arab revolt in Palestine against the British and the Jews in the first wave of organized violence, lasting until early 1937. Much of the Arab gangs were defeated by the British and a forced expulsion of much of the Arab leadership was performed. The revolt led to the establishment of the Peel Commission towards partitioning of Palestine, though was subsequently rejected by the Palestinian Arabs. The two main Jewish leaders, Chaim Weizmann and David Ben-Gurion, accepted the recommendations, but some secondary Jewish leaders did not like it. The renewed violence, which had sporadically lasted until the beginning of World War II, ended with around 5,000 casualties, mostly from the Arab side. With the eruption of World War II, the situation in Mandatory Palestine calmed down. It allowed a shift towards a more moderate stance among Palestinian Arabs, under the leadership of the Nashashibi clan and even the establishment of the Jewish Arab Palestine Regiment under British command, fighting Germans in North Africa. The more radical exiled faction of al-Husseini, however, tended to cooperation with Nazi Germany, and participated in the establishment of pro-Nazi propaganda machine throughout the Arab world. Defeat of Arab nationalists in Iraq and subsequent relocation of al-Husseini to Nazi-occupied Europe tied his hands regarding field operations in Palestine, though he regularly demanded the Italians and the Germans to bomb Tel Aviv by the end of World War II, a crisis over the fate of The Holocaust survivors from Europe led to renewed tensions between the Yishuv and the Palestinian Arab leadership. Immigration quotas were established by the British, while on the other hand illegal immigration and Zionist insurgency against the British was increasing. Land in the lighter shade represents territory within the borders of Israel at the conclusion of the 1948 war. This land is internationally recognized as belonging to Israel on 29 November 1947. The General Assembly of the United Nations adopted Resolution 181II recommending the adoption and implementation of a plan to partition Palestine into an Arab state, a Jewish state, and the city of Jerusalem. On the next day, Palestine was already swept by violence, with Arab and Jewish militias executing attacks for 4 months. Under continuous Arab provocation and attack, the Yishuv was usually on the defensive while occasionally retaliating. The Arab League supported the Arab struggle by forming the volunteer-based Arab Liberation Army, supporting the Palestinian Arab Army of the Holy War, under the leadership of Abd al-Qadir al-Husayni and Hassan Salama. On the Jewish side, the civil war was managed by the major underground militias, the Haganah, Irgun and Lehi, strengthened by numerous Jewish veterans of World War II and foreign volunteers. By spring 1948, it was already clear that the Arab forces were nearing a total collapse, while Yishuv forces gained more and more territory, creating a large-scale refugee problem of Palestinian Arabs. Popular support for the Palestinian Arabs throughout the Arab world led to sporadic violence against Jewish communities of Middle East and North Africa, creating an opposite refugee wave. Modern evolution of Palestine v.e. 1916-22 proposals. Three proposals for the post-World War I administration of Palestine. The Red Line is the international administration proposed in the 1916 Sykes-Picot Agreement. The Dashed Blue Line is the 1919 Zionist Organization proposal at the Paris Peace Conference, and the Thin Blue Line refers to the final borders of the 1923-48 Mandatory Palestine 1937 proposal. The first official proposal for partition, published in 1937 by the Peel Commission, an ongoing British mandate, was proposed to keep the sanctity of Jerusalem and Bethlehem, in the form of an enclave from Jerusalem to Jaffa, including Lydda and Ramleh. 1947 proposal, proposal per the United Nations Partition Plan for Palestine, UN General Assembly Resolution 181-2, 1947. Prior to the 1948 Arab-Israeli War, the proposal included a corpus separatum for Jerusalem, extraterritorial crossroads between the non-contiguous areas, and Jaffa as an Arab exclave. 1948-67 actual, the Jordanian annexed West Bank light green and Egyptian-occupied Gaza Strip dark green. After the 1948 Arab-Israeli War, showing 1949 armistice lines. 1967-1994, during the Six-Day War, Israel captured the West Bank, the Gaza Strip, and the Golan Heights, together with the Sinai Peninsula, later traded for peace after the Yom Kippur War. In 1980-81, Israel annexed East Jerusalem and the Golan Heights. Neither Israel's annexation nor Palestine's claim over East Jerusalem has been internationally recognized. 1994-2006, under the Oslo Accords, the Palestinian National Authority was created to provide civil government in certain urban areas of the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. 2006-present, after the Israeli disengagement from Gaza and clashes between the two main Palestinian parties following the Hamas electoral victory, two separate executive governments took control in Gaza and the West Bank. History. Main article, History of the Israeli-Palestinian Conflict following the declaration of the establishment of the State of Israel on 14 May 1948. The Arab League decided to intervene on behalf of Palestinian Arabs, marching their forces into former British Palestine, beginning the main phase of the 1948 Arab-Israeli War. The overall fighting, leading to around 15,000 casualties, resulted in ceasefire and armistice agreements of 1949, with Israel holding much of the former Mandate territory, Jordan occupying and later annexing the West Bank, and Egypt taking over the Gaza Strip, where the All-Palestine government was declared by the Arab League on the 22nd of September 1948. Through the 1950s, Jordan and Egypt supported the Palestinian Fedayeen and militants' cross-border attacks into Israel, while Israel carried out reprisal operations in the host countries. The 1956 Suez Crisis resulted in a short-term Israeli occupation of the Gaza Strip and exile of the All-Palestine government, which was later restored with Israeli withdrawal. The All-Palestine government was completely abandoned by Egypt in 1959 and was officially merged into the United Arab Republic, to the detriment of the Palestinian national movement. Gaza Strip then was put under the authority of Egyptian military administrator, making it a de facto military occupation in 1964. However, a new organization, the Palestine Liberation Organization PLO, was established by Yasser Arafat. It immediately won the support of most Arab League governments and was granted a seat in the Arab League. The 1967 Six-Day War exerted a significant effect upon Palestinian nationalism, as Israel gained military control of the West Bank from Jordan and the Gaza Strip from Egypt. Consequently, the PLO was unable to establish any control on the ground and established its headquarters in Jordan, home to hundreds of thousands of Palestinians, and supported the Jordanian army during the War of Attrition, most notably the Battle of Karameh. However, the Palestinian base in Jordan collapsed with the Jordanian-Palestinian Civil War in 1970. The PLO defeat by the Jordanians caused most of the Palestinian militants to relocate to South Lebanon, where they soon took over large areas, creating the so-called Fatah. Palestinian insurgency in South Lebanon peaked in the early 1970s, as Lebanon was used as a base to launch attacks on northern Israel and airplane hijacking campaigns worldwide, which drew Israeli retaliation during the Lebanese Civil War. Palestinian militants continued to launch attacks against Israel while also battling opponents within Lebanon. In 1978, the Coastal Road Massacre led to the Israeli full-scale invasion known as Operation Litani. Israeli forces, however, quickly withdrew from Lebanon, and the attacks against Israel resumed in 1982, following an assassination attempt on one of its diplomats by Palestinians. The Israeli government decided to take sides in the Lebanese Civil War, and the 1982 Lebanon War commenced. The initial results for Israel were successful. Most Palestinian militants were defeated within several weeks, Beirut was captured, and the PLO headquarters were evacuated to Tunisia in June by Yasser Arafat's decision. However, Israeli intervention in the Civil War also led to unforeseen results, including small-scale conflict between Israel and Syria. By 1985, Israel withdrew to a 10. Palestinian National Security Forces and the Israel Defense Forces, lasted until 2004-2005 and led to approximately 130 fatalities in 2005. Israeli Prime Minister Sharon ordered the removal of Israeli settlers and soldiers from Gaza. Israel and its Supreme Court formally declared an end to occupation, saying it had no effective control over what occurred in Gaza. However, the United Nations, Human Rights Watch and many other international bodies and NGOs continue to consider Israel to be the occupying power of the Gaza Strip, as Israel controls Gaza Strip's airspace, territorial waters, and controls the movement of people or goods in or out of Gaza by air or sea. In 2006, Hamas won a plurality of 44% in the Palestinian parliamentary election. Israel responded it would begin economic sanctions unless Hamas agreed to accept prior Israeli-Palestinian agreements, forswear violence, and recognize Israel's right to exist, which Hamas rejected after internal Palestinian political struggle between Fatah and Hamas erupted into the Battle of Gaza. 2007, Hamas took full control of the area. In 2007, Israel imposed a naval blockade on the Gaza Strip, and cooperation with Egypt allowed a ground blockade of the Egyptian border. The tensions between Israel and Hamas escalated until late 2008, when Israel launched Operation Cast Lead upon Gaza, resulting in thousands of civilian casualties and billions of dollars in damage. By February 2009, a ceasefire was signed with international mediation between the parties, though the occupation and small and sporadic eruptions of violence continued. In 2011, a Palestinian Authority attempt to gain UN membership as a fully sovereign state failed in Hamas-controlled Gaza. Sporadic rocket attacks on Israel and Israeli air raids still take place. In November 2012, the representation of Palestine in UN was upgraded to a non-member observer state, and its mission title was changed from Palestine represented by PLO to State of Palestine. Peace process. Main article, Israeli-Palestinian peace process. Oslo Accords 1993. Main article, Oslo Accords. A peace movement poster, Israeli and Palestinian flags and the words peace in Arabic and Hebrew. In 1993, Israeli officials led by Yitzhak Rabin and Palestinian leaders from the Palestine Liberation Organization led by Yasser Arafat strove to find a peaceful solution through what became known as the Oslo peace process. A crucial milestone in this process was Arafat's letter of recognition of Israel's right to exist. In 1993, the Oslo Accords were finalized as a framework for future Israeli-Palestinian relations. The crux of the Oslo Agreement was that Israel would gradually cede control of the Palestinian territories over to the Palestinians in Exchange for peace. The Oslo process was delicate and progressed in fits and starts. The process took a turning point at the assassination of Yitzhak Rabin and finally unraveled when Arafat and Ehud Barak failed to reach agreement at Camp David in July 2000. Robert Malley, special assistant to U.S. President Bill Clinton for Arab-Israeli affairs, has confirmed that while Barak made no formal written offer to Arafat, the U.S. did present concepts for peace which were considered by the Israeli side yet left unanswered by Arafat. The Palestinians' principal failing is that from the beginning of the Camp David summit onward they were unable either to say yes to the American ideas or to present a cogent and specific counterproposal of their own. Consequently, there are different accounts of the proposals considered. Camp David Summit 2000 Main Article, 2000 Camp David Summit. Yitzhak Rabin, Bill Clinton, and Yasser Arafat during the Oslo Accords on 13 September 1993. In July 2000, U.S. President Bill Clinton convened a peace summit between Palestinian President Yasser Arafat and Israeli Prime Minister Ehud Barak. Barak reportedly put forward the following as basis for negotiation, via the U.S. to the Palestinian president: a non-militarized Palestinian state split into 3 to 4 parts containing 87 to 92% of the West Bank, including only parts of East Jerusalem, and the entire Gaza Strip. The offer also included that 69 Jewish settlements, which comprise 85% of the West Bank's Jewish settlers, would be ceded to Israel, no right of return to Israel, no sovereignty over the Temple Mount or any core East Jerusalem neighborhoods, and continued Israel control over the Jordan Valley. Arafat rejected this offer. According to the Palestinian negotiators, the offer did not remove many of the elements of the Israeli occupation regarding land, security, settlements, and Jerusalem. President Clinton reportedly requested that Arafat make a counter-offer, but he proposed none. Former Israeli Foreign Minister Shlomo Ben-Ami, who kept a diary of the negotiations, said in an interview in 2001, when asked whether the Palestinians made a counterproposal, "No, and that is the heart of the matter. Never, in the negotiations between us and the Palestinians, was there a Palestinian counterproposal." In a separate interview in 2006, Ben-Ami stated that were he a Palestinian he would have rejected the Camp David offer. No tenable solution was crafted which would satisfy both Israeli and Palestinian demands. Even under intense U.S. pressure, Clinton has long blamed Arafat for the collapse of the summit. In the months following the summit, Clinton appointed former U.S. Senator George J. Mitchell to lead a fact-finding committee aiming to identify strategies for restoring the peace process. The committee's findings were published in 2001, with the dismantlement of existing Israeli settlements and Palestinian crackdown on militant activity being one strategy. Developments following Camp David Main Article, the Clinton parameters following the failed summit. Palestinian and Israeli negotiators continued to meet in small groups through August and September 2000 to try to bridge the gaps between their respective positions. The United States prepared its own plan to resolve the outstanding issues. Clinton's presentation of the U.S. proposals was delayed by the advent of the Second Intifada at the end of September. Clinton's plan, eventually presented on 23 December 2000, proposed the establishment of a sovereign Palestinian state in the Gaza Strip and 94 to 96% of the West Bank, plus the equivalent of 1 to 3% of the West Bank in land swaps from pre-1967 Israel on Jerusalem. The plan stated that the general principle is that Arab areas are Palestinian and that Jewish areas are Israeli. The holy sites were to be split on the basis that Palestinians would have sovereignty over the Temple Mount, Noble Sanctuary, while the Israelis would have sovereignty over the Western Wall on refugees. The plan suggested a number of proposals, including financial compensation, the right of return to the Palestinian state, and Israeli acknowledgement of suffering caused to the Palestinians in 1948. Security proposals referred to a non-militarized Palestinian state and an international force for border security. Both sides accepted Clinton's plan, and it became the basis for the negotiations at the Taba Peace Summit. The following January Taba Summit 2001 Main Article, Taba Summit. The Israeli negotiation team presented a new map at the Taba Summit in Taba, Egypt in January 2001. The proposition removed the temporarily Israeli-controlled areas, and the Palestinian side accepted this as a basis for further negotiation with Israeli elections looming. The talks ended without an agreement, but the two sides issued a joint statement attesting to the progress they had made. The sides declare that they have never been closer to reaching an agreement, and it is thus our shared belief that the remaining gaps could be bridged with the resumption of negotiations following the Israeli elections. The following month, the Likud party candidate Ariel Sharon defeated Ehud Barak in the Israeli elections and was elected as Israeli Prime Minister on 7 February 2001. Sharon's new government chose not to resume the high-level talks Road Map for Peace main article, Road Map for Peace 1 Peace Proposal, presented by the Quartet of the European Union, Russia, the United Nations and the United States on 17 September 2002, was the Road Map for Peace. This plan did not attempt to resolve difficult questions such as the fate of Jerusalem or Israeli settlements, but left that to be negotiated in later phases of the process. The proposal never made it beyond the first phase, whose goals called for a halt to both Israeli settlement construction and Israeli-Palestinian violence. Neither goal has been achieved as of November 2015. Arab Peace Initiative main article, Arab Peace Initiative. The Arab Peace Initiative Arabic, Mubadirat as-Salam al-Arabiya, was first proposed by Crown Prince Abdullah of Saudi Arabia in the Beirut summit. The Peace Initiative is a proposed solution to the Arab-Israeli conflict as a whole, and the Israeli-Palestinian conflict in particular. The initiative was initially published on 28 March 2002, at the Beirut summit, and agreed upon again in 2007 in the Riyadh summit. Unlike the Road Map for Peace, it spelled out final solution borders based explicitly on the UN borders established before the 1967 Six-Day War. It offered full normalization of relations with Israel, in exchange for the withdrawal of its forces from all the occupied territories, including the Golan Heights, to recognize an independent Palestinian state with East Jerusalem as its capital in the West Bank and Gaza Strip, as well as a just solution for the Palestinian refugees. A number of Israeli officials have responded to the initiative with both support and criticism. The Israeli government has expressed reservations on red line issues such as the Palestinian refugee problem, homeland security concerns, and the nature of Jerusalem. However, the Arab League continues to raise it as a possible solution, and meetings between the Arab League and Israel have been held. Present status: the peace process has been predicated on a two-state solution thus far, but questions have been raised towards both sides' resolve to end the dispute. And article by S. Daniel Abraham, an American entrepreneur and founder of the Center for Middle East Peace in Washington, U.S., published on the website of The Atlantic magazine in March 2013, cited the following statistics. Right now, the total number of Jews and Arabs living in Israel, the West Bank, and Gaza is just under 12 million people at the moment, a shade under 50% of the population is Jewish. Israel's settlement policy. Israeli settlers in Hebron, West Bank. Israel has had its settlement growth and policies in the Palestinian territories harshly criticized by the European Union, citing it as increasingly undermining the viability of the two-state solution and running in contrary to the Israeli stated commitment to resume negotiations in December 2011, all the regional groupings on the UN Security Council named continued settlement construction and settler violence as disruptive to the resumption of talks, a call viewed by Russia as a historic step. In April 2012, international outrage followed Israeli steps to further entrench the Jewish settlements in the West Bank, including East Jerusalem, which included the publishing of tenders for further settler homes and the plan to legalize settler outposts. Britain said that the move was a breach of Israeli commitments under the Road Map to freeze all settlement expansion in the land captured since 1967. The British Foreign Minister stated that the systematic, illegal Israeli settlement activity poses the most significant and live threat to the viability of the two-state solution. In May 2012, the 27 foreign ministers of the European Union issued a statement which condemned continued Israeli settler violence and incitement. In a similar move, the Quartet expressed its concern over ongoing settler violence and incitement in the West Bank, calling on Israel to take effective measures, including bringing the perpetrators of such acts to justice. The Palestinian Ma'an news agency reported the PA cabinet's statement on the issue stated that the West, including East Jerusalem, were seeing an escalation in incitement and settler violence against our people with a clear protection from the occupation military, the last of which was the thousands of settler march in East Jerusalem, which included slogans inciting to kill, hate and supports violence. Israeli military police chemical burns on a 15-year-old Palestinian child following Israeli bombings in the village of Kosa, Gaza. In a report published in February 2014 covering incidents over the three-year period of 2011-2013, Amnesty International asserted that Israeli forces employed reckless violence in the West Bank, and in some instances appeared to engage in willful killings which would be tantamount to war crimes. Besides the numerous fatalities, Amnesty said at least 261 Palestinians, including 67 children, had been gravely injured by Israeli use of live ammunition in this same period. 45 Palestinians, including 6 children, had been killed. Amnesty's review of 25 civilians' deaths concluded that in no case was there evidence of the Palestinians posing an imminent threat at the same time. Over 8,000 Palestinians suffered serious injuries from other means, including rubber-coated metal bullets. Only one IDF soldier was convicted, killing a Palestinian attempting to enter Israel illegally. The soldier was demoted and given a 1-year sentence with a 5-month suspension. The IDF answered the charges, stating that its army held itself to the highest of professional standards, adding that when there was suspicion of wrongdoing, it investigated and took action where appropriate. Incitement: a fatally wounded Israeli schoolboy, 2011. Following the Oslo Accords, which was to set up regulative bodies to rein in frictions, Palestinian incitement against Israel, Jews, and Zionism continued, parallel with Israel's pursuance of settlements in the Palestinian territories, though under Abu Mazen it has reportedly dwindled significantly. Charges of incitement have been reciprocal, both sides interpreting media statements in the Palestinian and Israeli press as constituting incitement in Israeli usage. The term also covers failures to mention Israel's culture and history in Palestinian textbooks. Perpetrators of murderous attack, whether against Israelis or Palestinians, often find strong vocal support from sections of their communities. Despite varying levels of condemnation from politicians, both parties to the conflict have been criticized by third parties for teaching incitement to their children by downplaying each side's historical ties to the area, teaching propagandist maps, or indoctrinate their children to one day join the armed forces. UN and the Palestinian state. The PLO's campaign for full member status for the state of Palestine at the UN and have recognition on the 1967 borders received widespread support, though it was criticized by some countries for purportedly avoiding bilateral negotiation. Netanyahu expressed criticism of the Palestinians as he felt that they were allegedly trying to bypass direct talks, whereas Abbas argued that the continued construction of Israeli-Jewish settlements was undermining the realistic potential for the two-state solution, although denied full member status by the UN Security Council. In late 2012, the UN General Assembly overwhelmingly approved the de facto recognition of sovereign Palestine by granting non-member state status. Public support polling data has produced mixed results regarding the level of support among Palestinians for the two-state solution. A poll was carried out in 2011 by the Hebrew University. It indicated that support for a two-state solution was growing among both Israelis and Palestinians. The poll found that 58% of Israelis and 50% of Palestinians supported a two-state solution based on the Clinton parameters, compared with 47% of Israelis and 39% of Palestinians in 2003. The first year the poll was carried out, the poll also found that an increasing percentage of both populations supported an end to violence, 63% of Palestinians and 70% of Israelis expressing their support for an end to violence, an increase of 2% for Israelis and 5% for Palestinians from the previous year. Current issues in dispute. The following outlined positions are the official positions of the two parties. However, it is important to note that neither side holds a single position. Both the Israeli and the Palestinian sides include both moderate and extremist bodies, as well as dovish and hawkish bodies. One of the primary obstacles to resolving the Israeli-Palestinian conflict is a deep-set and growing distrust between its participants' unilateral strategies and the rhetoric of hard-line political factions, coupled with violence and incitements by civilians against one another, have fostered mutual embitterment and hostility, and a loss of faith in the peace process. Support among Palestinians for Hamas is considerable, and as its members consistently call for the destruction of Israel and violence remains a threat, security becomes a prime concern for many Israelis. The expansion of Israeli settlements in the West Bank has led the majority of Palestinians to believe that Israel is not committed to reaching an agreement, but rather to a pursuit of establishing permanent control over this territory in order to provide that security. Jerusalem main article, positions on Jerusalem. See also, Western Wall, Temple Mount, and Al-Aqsa Mosque. Greater Jerusalem, May 2006. CIA remote sensing map showing what the CIA regards as settlements, plus refugee camps, fences, and walls. The control of Jerusalem is a particularly delicate issue, with each side asserting claims over this city. The three largest Abrahamic religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, hold Jerusalem is an important setting for their religious and historical narratives. Jerusalem is the holiest city in the world for Judaism, being the former location of the Jewish temples on the Temple Mount and the capital of the ancient Israelite kingdom for Muslims. Jerusalem is the site of Muhammad's night journey to heaven, and the Al-Aqsa Mosque for Christians. Jerusalem is the site of Jesus' crucifixion and the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. The Israeli government, including the Knesset and Supreme Court, is centered in the New City of West Jerusalem and has been since Israel's founding in 1948 after Israel captured the Jordanian-controlled East Jerusalem in the Six-Day War. It assumed complete administrative control of East Jerusalem in 1980. Israel issued a new law stating that Jerusalem, complete and united, is the capital of Israel. No country in the world except for Israel has recognized Jerusalem as Israel's capital. The majority of UN member states and most international organizations do not recognize Israel's ownership of East Jerusalem, which occurred after the 1967 Six-Day War, nor its 1980 Jerusalem Law Proclamation. The International Court of Justice, in its 2004 advisory opinion on the legal consequences of the construction of a wall in the occupied Palestinian territory, described East Jerusalem as occupied Palestinian territory. As of 2005, there were more than 719,000 people living in Jerusalem, 465,000 were Jews mostly living in West Jerusalem and 232,000 were Muslims mostly living in East Jerusalem. At the Camp David and Taba summits in 2001, the United States proposed a plan in which the Arab parts of Jerusalem would be given to the proposed Palestinian state while the Jewish parts of Jerusalem were given to Israel. All archaeological work under the Temple Mount would be jointly controlled by the Israeli and Palestinian governments. Both sides accepted the proposal in principle, but the summits ultimately failed. Israel expresses concern over the security of its residents if neighborhoods of Jerusalem are placed under Palestinian control. Jerusalem has been a prime target for attacks by militant groups against civilian targets since 1967. Many Jewish neighborhoods have been fired upon from Arab areas. The proximity of the Arab areas, if these regions were to fall in the boundaries of a Palestinian state, would be so close as to threaten the safety of Jewish residents. Holy sites. Israel has concerns regarding the welfare of Jewish holy places under possible Palestinian control. When Jerusalem was under Jordanian control, no Jews were allowed to visit the Western Wall or other Jewish holy places, and the Jewish cemetery on the Mount of Olives was desecrated since 1975. Israel has banned Muslims from worshipping at Joseph's Tomb, a shrine considered sacred by both Jews and Muslims. Settlers established a yeshiva, installed a Torah scroll, and covered the mihrab during the Second Intifada. The site was looted and burned. Israeli security agencies routinely monitor and arrest Jewish extremists that plan attacks. Though many serious incidents have still occurred, Israel has allowed almost complete autonomy to the Muslim Trust WAQF over the Temple Mount. Palestinians have voiced concerns regarding the welfare of Christian and Muslim holy places under Israeli control. Additionally, some Palestinian advocates have made statements alleging that the Western Wall tunnel was reopened with the intent of causing the mosque's collapse. The Israel Ministry of Foreign Affairs denied this claim in a 1996 speech to the United Nations and characterized the statement as escalation of rhetoric. Palestinian refugees. See also Palestinian right of return, Palestinian refugee, and 1948 Palestinian exodus. Palestinian refugees. 1948 Palestinian refugees are people who lost both their homes and means of livelihood as a result of the 1948 Arab-Israeli conflict and the 1967 Six-Day War. The number of Palestinians who fled or were expelled from Israel following its creation was estimated at 711,000 in 1949. Descendants of these original Palestinian refugees are also eligible for registration and services provided by the United Nations Relief and Works Agency for Palestine Refugees in the Near East, UNRWA, and as of 2010 number 47 million people. Between 350,000 and 400,000 Palestinians were displaced during the 1967 Arab-Israeli War. A third of the refugees live in recognized refugee camps in Jordan, Lebanon, Syria, the West Bank, and the Gaza Strip. The remainder live in and around the cities and towns of these host countries. Most of these people were born outside of Israel, but are descendants of original Palestinian refugees. Palestinian negotiators, most notably Yasser Arafat, have so far publicly insisted that refugees have a right to return to the places where they lived before 1948 and 1967, including those within the 1949 armistice line. guidelines, citing the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and UN General Assembly Resolution 194 as evidence. However, according to reports of private peace negotiations with Israel, they have countenanced the return of only 10,000 refugees and their families to Israel as part of a peace settlement. Mahmoud Abbas, the current chairman of the Palestine Liberation Organization, was reported to have said in private discussion that it is illogical to ask Israel to take 5 million, or indeed 1 million, that would mean the end of Israel. In a further interview, Abbas stated that he no longer had an automatic right to return to Safed in the northern Galilee where he was born in 1935. He later clarified that the remark was his personal opinion and not official policy. The Arab Peace Initiative of 2002 declared that it proposed the compromise of a just resolution of the refugee problem. Palestinian and international authors have justified the right of return of the Palestinian refugees on several grounds. Several scholars included in the broader New Historians argue that the Palestinian refugees were chased out or expelled by the actions of the Haganah, Lehi and Irgun, Zionist paramilitary groups. A number have also characterized this as an ethnic cleansing. The New Historians cite indications of Arab leaders' desire for the Palestinian Arab population to stay put. Slame 2000 states that from April 1948 the military forces of what was to become Israel had embarked on a new offensive strategy which involved destroying Arab villages and the forced removal of civilians' home in Balada refugee camp demolished during the Second Intifada. 2002 The Israeli law of return that grants citizenship to any Jew from anywhere in the world is viewed by some as discrimination against non-Jews, especially Palestinians that cannot apply for such citizenship or return to the territory which they were expelled from or fled during the course of the 1948 war. According to the UN Resolution 194, adopted in 1948, the refugees wishing to return to their homes and live at peace with their neighbors should be permitted to do so at the earliest practicable date, and that compensation should be paid for the property of those choosing not to return and for loss of or damage to property which, under principles of international law or in equity, should be made good by the governments or authorities responsible. UN Resolution 3236 reaffirms also the inalienable right of the Palestinians to return to their homes and property from which they have been displaced and uprooted, and calls for their return. Resolution 242 from the UN affirms the necessity for achieving a just settlement of the refugee problem. However, Resolution 242 does not specify that the just settlement must or should be in the form of a literal Palestinian right of return. The most common arguments for opposition are, the Israeli government asserts that the Arab refugee problem is largely caused by the refusal of all Arab governments except Jordan to grant citizenship to Palestinian Arabs who reside within those countries' borders. This has produced much of the poverty and economic problems of the refugees. According to MFA documents, the Palestinian refugee issue is handled by a separate authority from that handling other refugees, that is, by UNRWA and not the UNHCR. Most of the people recognizing themselves as Palestinian refugees would have otherwise been assimilated into their country of current residency, and would not maintain their refugee state if not for the separate entities. Citation needed. Concerning the origin of the Palestinian refugees, the official version of the Israeli government is that during the 1948 war the Arab Higher Committee and the Arab states encouraged Palestinians to flee in order to make it easier to rout the Jewish state, or that they did so to escape the fights by fear. The Palestinian narrative is that refugees were expelled and dispossessed by Jewish militias and by the Israeli army, following a plan established even before the war. Historians still debate the causes of the 1948 Palestinian exodus, since none of the 900,000 Jewish refugees who fled anti-Semitic violence in the Arab world was ever compensated or repatriated by their former countries of residence. To no objection on the part of Arab leaders, a precedent has been set whereby it is the responsibility of the nation which accepts the refugees to assimilate them, although Israel accepts the right of the Palestinian diaspora to return into a new Palestinian state. Israel insists that their return into the current state of Israel would be a great danger for the stability of the Jewish state. An influx of Palestinian refugees would lead to the destruction of the state of Israel. Historian Benny Morris states that most of Palestine's 700,000 refugees fled because of the flail of war and expected to return home shortly after a successful Arab invasion. He documents instances in which Arab leaders advised the evacuation of entire communities, as happened in Haifa in his scholarly work. However, he does conclude that there were expulsions which were carried out. Morris considers the displacement the result of a national conflict initiated by the Arabs themselves. In a 2004 interview with Haaretz, he described the exodus as largely resulting from an atmosphere of transfer that was promoted by Ben-Gurion and understood by the military leadership. He also claimed that there are circumstances in history that justify ethnic cleansing. He has been criticized by political scientist Norman Finkelstein for having seemingly changed his views for political, rather than historical, reasons. According to Karsh, the Palestinians were themselves the aggressors in the 1948-49 war who attempted to cleanse a neighboring ethnic community. Had the United Nations resolution of 29 November 1947 recommending partition in Palestine not been subverted by force by the Arab world, there would have been no refugee problem in the first place. He reports of large numbers of Palestinian refugees leaving even before the outbreak of the 1948 war because of disillusionment and economic privation. The British High Commissioner for Palestine spoke of the collapsing Arab morale in Palestine that he partially attributed to the increasing tendency of those who should be leading them to leave the country and the considerable evacuations of the Arab Effendi class. Huge numbers of Palestinians were also expelled by their leadership to prevent them from becoming Israeli citizens, and in Haifa and Tiberias, tens of thousands of Arabs were forcibly evacuated on the instructions of the Arab Higher Committee. Israeli security concerns. See also, United States security assistance to the Palestinian Authority, Palestinian political violence, and 2010 Palestinian militancy campaign. Remains of an egged bus hit by suicide bomber in the aftermath of the 2011 southern Israel cross-border attacks. 8 people were killed, about 40 were injured throughout the conflict. Palestinian violence has been a concern for Israelis. Israel, along with the United States and the European Union, refer to the violence against Israeli civilians and military forces by Palestinian militants as terrorism. The motivations behind Palestinian violence against Israeli civilians are multiplex, and not all violent Palestinian groups agree with each other on specifics. Nonetheless, a common motive is the desire to destroy Israel and replace it with a Palestinian Arab state. The most prominent Islamist groups, such as Hamas, view the Israeli-Palestinian conflict as a religious jihad. Suicide bombing is used as a tactic among Palestinian organizations like Hamas, Islamic Jihad, and the Al-Aqsa Martyrs Brigade, and certain suicide attacks have received support among Palestinians as high as 84% in Israel. Palestinian suicide bombers have targeted civilian buses, restaurants, shopping malls, hotels and marketplaces from 1993 to 2003. 303 Palestinian suicide bombers attacked Israel. The Israeli government initiated the construction of a security barrier following scores of suicide bombings and terrorist attacks in July 2003. Israel's coalition government approved the security barrier in the northern part of the Green Line between Israel and the West Bank. According to the IDF, since the erection of the fence, terrorist acts have declined by approximately 90% since 2001. The threat of Qassam rockets fired from the Palestinian territories into Israel is also of great concern for Israeli defense officials. In 2006, the year following Israel's disengagement from the Gaza Strip, the Israeli government recorded 1,726 such launches, more than 4 times the total rockets fired in 2005. As of January 2009, over 8,600 rockets had been launched, causing widespread psychological trauma and disruption of daily life. Over 500 rockets and mortars hit Israel in January to September 2010, and over 1,947 rockets hit Israel in January to November 2012. An Israeli child wounded by a Hamas Grad rocket fired on the city of Beer Sheva is taken to a hospital. According to a study conducted by University of Haifa, 1 in 5 Israelis have lost a relative or friend in a Palestinian terrorist attack. There is significant debate within Israel about how to deal with the country's security concerns. Options have included military action, including targeted killings and house demolitions of terrorist operatives, diplomacy, unilateral gestures toward peace, and increased security measures such as checkpoints, roadblocks and security barriers. The legality and the wisdom of all of the above tactics have been called into question by various commentators since mid-June 2007. Israel's primary means of dealing with security concerns in the West Bank has been to cooperate with and permit United States-sponsored training, equipping, and funding of the Palestinian Authority's security forces, which with Israeli help have largely succeeded in quelling West Bank supporters of Hamas. Palestinian violence outside of Israel, some Palestinians have committed violent acts over the globe on the pretext of a struggle against Israel. Many foreigners, including Americans and Europeans, have been killed and injured by Palestinian militants. At least 53 Americans have been killed and 83 injured by Palestinian violence since the signing of the Oslo Accords during the late 1960s. The PLO became increasingly infamous for its use of international terror in 1969 alone. The PLO was responsible for hijacking 82 planes. El Al Airlines became a regular hijacking target. The hijacking of Air France Flight 139 by the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine culminated during a hostage rescue mission, where Israeli special forces successfully rescued the majority of the hostages. However, one of the most well-known and notorious terrorist acts was the capture and eventual murder of 11 Israeli athletes during the 1972 Olympic Games. Israeli violence outside of Palestine. Israeli forces have launched attacks against Palestinians around the globe as part of the conflict. Israel has assassinated dozens of Palestinians and their supporters outside of Palestine, mainly in Europe and the Middle East. Israel has also bombed Palestinian targets in many nations such as Syria and Lebanon, including the bombing of the PLO headquarters in Tunisia, killing several hundred Palestinian violence against other Palestinians. Suspected Palestinian collaborator killed by Palestinians during the First Intifada. Fighting among rival Palestinian and Arab movements has played a crucial role in shaping Israel's security policy towards Palestinian militants, as well as in the Palestinian leadership's own policies as early as the 1930s revolts in Palestine. Arab forces fought each other while also skirmishing with Zionist and British forces, and internal conflicts continue to the present day. During the Lebanese Civil War, Palestinian Ba'athists broke from the Palestine Liberation Organization and allied with the Shia Amal movement, fighting a bloody civil war that killed thousands of Palestinians in the First Intifada. More than 1,000 Palestinians were killed in a campaign initiated by the Palestine Liberation Organization to crack down on suspected Israeli security service.